Created the heaven and the earth, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And in the beginning was the world, and the world was God, and the world was God, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Please listen as we share the birth of Jesus Christ, the one who came to save a hopelessly lost world, for it was just Jesus who started the world saying,
Child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful, Counselor, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was on the wise, when as his mother Mary was espoused to Joseph, before they came together, she was found with child of the Holy Ghost. Then Joseph, her husband, being just a man, and not willing to make her a public example, was minded to put her away privately.
Lord, I have always tried to do your will. Please guide me. Help me to do what is right.
While Joseph thought on these things, behold, the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a dream.
Joseph, son of David, fear not to take unto thee Mary as thy wife, for which is conceived in her is of the Holy Ghost, and she shall bring forth a son, and she shall call his name Jesus. He shall save his people from their sins.
Joseph, being risen, rise from sleep, did as the angel of the Lord had bidden him, and took unto him Mary as his wife, and knew her not until she had brought forth her firstborn son. And it came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world shall be taxed.
And all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. Joseph was very concerned, because he was of the house of David. His hometown was Bethlehem, 70 miles or so away. It would be a long, tiring journey on donkey back over steep mountain trails and rough, rutted roads.
Thank you.
When Mary and Joseph finally reached Bethlehem, they found the inn full and overflowing.
We are so dying.
All of our rooms are taken. All we have left to offer is the stable.
Thank you. We are very grateful. Come on, Mary. Go get you some rest.
So it was were accomplished and that they should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothing. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in their field and keeping watch over their flock by night.
It's a relief that we got those sheep's held down. They were restless. It's almost as if they sensed something out of the ordinary is going to happen.
Yeah, they are uneasy, but I don't know why. They have plenty of grass to graze and water to drink.
The stars are so big, the stars are so bright, especially that one star.
I've never seen that star that big.
That's enough talk. Y'all get some rest. I'll take care of the watch.
Well, let's hope no wild animals or anything else gets to them so we can get some rest.
Wake up! Wake up! Shepherds, look!
And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone around about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them,
Fear not, for behold, I give you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a baby, wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.
And this shall be a sign unto you, and you shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, lying in a manger.
And suddenly, with the angel, a multitude of heavenly hosts praised God, and saying,
Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men. Did you see what I saw?
Angels everywhere.
Do you realize what this means? Our Messiah, our Savior, he is here. Get up, shepherds. Let's go and find him.
The angels were gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us now go, even unto Bethlehem, and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord hath made known unto us." And they came with haste, and they found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in the manger. And when they had seen it, they made known abroad the saying which was told them concerning this child. And all that heard it wondered at those which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary kept all these things and pondered them in her heart.
Listen, you can hear a mother singing, and her lullaby is floating on the air. Listen, it's coming from the stable. Why would anybody's baby be in there? Listen to the music coming from the stable. Listen. Listen.
Far to the east of Palestine, a little group of men not only saw the light, but were convinced it had some special meaning. Certainly they knew the Hebrew scriptures well, for they were sure that the time had come for the Messiah to be born. These wise men came from the east to Jerusalem, and they questioned King Herod. Chief priests and scribes tell him where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophet.
Go and search diligently for the young child, and when you do, bring me word again that I may go worship him also.
When they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. And when they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. And when they were coming to the house, they saw the young child with Mary, his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto gifts unto him.
I bring gold, said the crown of mother.
Gold, the gift for royalty, a gift fit for a king.
I bring frankincense.
Frankincense, licensed traditionally used in Jewish worship as a continual flame that lifted the prayers of the people to God. This was a tribute that Jesus was truly the Son of God.
I bring
myrrh. At last, myrrh was for burials. It was placed in the cloths used to wrap the bodies for burial. The gift symbolically stated that Jesus was born to be a sacrifice for our sins.
The wise men were warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, so they departed into their own country another way. Thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save people from their sins. The angel Gabriel spoke these words more than 2,000 years ago. The birth of Jesus has set in motion God's incredible plan of salvation. As God had promised, this precious child would grow up to break the power of Satan. He was buried, but glory be to God, our Savior did not stay in that tomb. He arose triumph over death and the grave. That very same Jesus has promised that he will come again, and at that time every knee shall bow, and every tongue confess that Jesus is Lord. No more tears, no more death, for all those that love him and are called according to his purpose. Glory to God. We will sing a new song and live with him forevermore.
Thank you. Please, Joel, turn those spotlights off, please. A lot, okay? Are you just staring at me and not going to do it? Oh, praise the Lord. Man, wasn't that good? Everything you see on stage was built by members of our church. The paintings that you see were done by some of the adults and the kids who were involved in it. Everything. I mean, it's so good, and we appreciate them. But the most important thing is you heard the message about Jesus. He was born, and as was said in the closing, he was born to die. You know, that whole thought caught me this week, and I pondered on it for a long time. And there's a verse of scripture that came to mind. I'm going to share it with you briefly today. In John chapter 12, it was Passion Week. It began with what we know as Palm Sunday. And Jesus had come to town riding on a donkey. That was Bill, right? He rode on the real thing. But he came riding on a donkey, and they threw down palm branches, and they praised him as the Son of David and said, "Glory to God in the highest." Hosanna, they gave him. Was a form of worship. And sometime during that week, now you got to know it was, excuse me, Passover week, and Jerusalem was filled with travelers. There were literally thousands of people there. And so some of the people that were foreigners, they were Greeks, they came to one of Jesus' followers. His name was Philip. And they said, "We want to see Jesus. We've heard about him, but we want to see him." So Philip went and got his brother Andrew, and he said, "These guys want to see Jesus." And they brought him to Jesus, and they were so enamored with the popularity that was going on. But Jesus made a statement to them that was, it seemed almost sarcastic, but I know he wasn't being sarcastic. What he was doing was teaching them about a very deeper purpose than him receiving the worship of the masses of the people. Here's what he said. He said, "Except a grain of corn or wheat fall into the ground and die, it can't produce fruit. And he was talking about his death. And he said in John 12, verse 27, "This is the reason, the purpose for which I came into this world." We love to worship the babe in Bethlehem. We love to think about it, but we don't like to think about the fact that, listen, those little hands that Mary had and those little feet that she tickled would be pierced with nails one day. And she cuddled him, swallowed him there in Bethlehem's manger. She knew, as was quoted in the play, that he was born to die. How was he born to die? He was born to die, first of all, listen, because there was no salvation in his birth. I believe Jesus was born of a virgin. I said, I believe Jesus was born of a virgin. Listen, I don't know if you can go to heaven if you don't believe it. Because if Jesus wasn't born of a virgin, he said he was, that makes him a liar. And if he's a liar, he can't be Lord. Amen? So, but even though he was born of a virgin, and the Bible teaches that, and we believe it, just because he was born of a virgin, that wouldn't bring our salvation. I believe Jesus lived a sinless, perfect life. But just having lived a sinless, perfect life would not buy our salvation. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of our sin. Jesus had to die for our salvation. He was born to die because he had to pay the price for our sin. The Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5, verse number 21, "He hath made him who knew no sin to be made sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him." Without his death, we would not be able to receive his righteousness. And the Bible says we don't have enough to get to heaven on our own.
Right.
He had to die to pay the price for our sins. He was born to die so that we might live. There's a passage of Scripture. We're going through Romans on Wednesday night. We've been in Romans since the last part of 2020. But Romans chapter 5, verses 7 and 8. I want you to listen to it, and I'll be done today. I mean that. For scarcely would a righteous man die. Peradventure for a good man, some would dare to die. But God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He did die. He didn't have to die. He came to fulfill the will of the Father. But he came to earth for that purpose. I've heard preachers say down through the years that one day they had a meeting in heaven. And they sat down together, all of those residents of the heavens at the time, and they said, we're going to have to do something about what's going on earth. And they didn't know what to do. And as the story goes, finally Jesus said, I'll go down there and I'll pay for your sins. Folks, that wasn't the way it happened. It was pre-planned before man was ever made and created by God. God wasn't surprised when Adam and Eve sinned. He knew what was going to happen, and that's why it was prophesied in Genesis chapter 3 about Jesus and the serpent that Folks, I'm glad Jesus was born. And I'm glad he lived a sinless life. But I'm thankful for my salvation because he died on the cross and was buried and rose again. Would you bow your heads for just a moment, please? Jesus was born to die so that we might live. We're going to have a verse of invitation. I would like our pianist to come and our song leader and pick a song that the Lord would lead you to. You may be here today and you've heard about Jesus, but you don't know him personally. All you have to do is admit that you're a sinner and be willing to believe in him and ask him to forgive you of your sins and to be your Savior. The Bible says, whosoever will call upon the name of the Lord will be saved. And that's all it requires of you is to admit you're a sinner, believe that he can save. If you've never done that, would you do that? Would you ask Jesus, would you receive the gift of God? Would you return the life to Jesus Christ? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that we've said and heard today. Our hearts were joyed to watch these young people and those who helped them so much. And Lord, they gave the message of salvation. And now as we give this invitation, we pray that someone will realize that they're not going to go to heaven, and they can, by admitting, calling on your name, and believing. Father, do your work in me, and get glory for what happens. In Jesus' name, amen. While we stand together, Lord, we